Good afternoon. All right, I'm gonna, we don't want to take up too much of your time. You should receive a yellow sheet of paper if you have your standard teaching certificate, and the blue copy is if you are still holding an initial certificate. I want to introduce Susan Sarfaty. She's the regional superintendent. I think everybody has met her or seen her at one point through the ROA or on campus. She's going to speak to you today about that we're going to be moving from, or actually the state is moving from, the ECS system that you log in all your professional development to the ELIS system. So she's going to walk you through this today. We are videotaping it. I'm going to figure out a way with JJ that we can even have access to that as well after she presents at West on Thursday. That way we just need a refresher, and we'll also have the handouts online. Thanks. I don't know why you want to watch this again, but once would be plenty. Thank you very, very much for coming today. I know that today it's absolutely gorgeous out, and the last thing that you really want to do is to sit inside and talk about your certificate. And I also know at the end of the school year you have a million and one things to do, but without having a valid certificate, you can't do those million and one things. So my goal is today to get you, to help you understand what the changes are and where you can go for help. One of the things I can tell you for sure is that what we talk about today is what I know today, but it could change between now and the end of June. And that's because, first of all, certification is a very fluid thing. If you've been in teaching very long, you know that certification does not stay the same. So what you heard maybe 5 or 6 years ago is vastly different than what is happening today. The second reason I know things are going to change is that about last month, we were at the regional, at the state board, and talking with the certification people. And from the start of our meeting to the end of our meeting, three things changed as we talked through the processes. There's also another thing called administrative rules that have just been approved by the state board, but have to go in front of another group of attorneys to make sure it's legal. And the administrative rules tells us all the details about this switchover from certificates to licenses. So stay tuned. The way I will let you know as things change is I have the administration, I've got superintendents and your principals on the listserv, and as things change, I will send out an email to them to ask them to forward it to you. And in the subject line, I'll put the word licensure, so please don't just delete that, please open it up and read it. If it's something that pertains, for example, only to administrators, those with Type 75 certificates, I'll try to remember to put that in the subject box as well, so you don't read things you don't need, but please remember that I'm trying to keep you as updated as I can. You can also go to our website and click on the certification link. I'll put things up as they change on that link. Or if you're having trouble sleeping, you can go to the state board website and read their pages and pages about certification and licensure. But as we move into this new system, I want to tell you first of all why we're doing it. Right now, the state board issues over 60 different numbers of certificates. The elementary, the early childhood, the high school, the special certificate, the Type 73 for social workers and school nurses, and the 75 and the 39, and you get the idea. They go on and on and on. So about 5 years ago, they decided that they wanted to condense all those certificates into one. And they got close. They got down to three. By show of hands, is anyone here with a provisional, temporary provisional, or a vocational certificate? Do we have any vocational people? Okay. I won't talk about that group. The only one we need to talk about today is the one that confirms teachers and school certified personnel that have completed a full program. For example, anybody with a Type 73, a 75, or an 09. So that's the one we're going to talk about today. If you really want to know about the other two, call me and I'll tell you, but you probably don't want to take your time to learn about those because they don't apply. So the certificate exchange is going to happen on June the 30th. That part of the whole process, you don't have to do anything to happen. You're going to wake up on July 1, and magically have a new license. Now, why we're switching from certificates to licenses, I don't know. Certificates is certainly a lot easier to say, and I'll probably at some point in our talk today call it a certificate instead of a license. But after July 1, you will have one license. No matter how many certificates you have now, and some people may have two or three, no matter how many you have, you will only end up with one license, and it's going to be called a professional educator license. Now, we love acronyms in education, so this has an acronym, and it's called a PEL. So we're going to be talking about your PEL. And on your PEL license, everything will be listed as an endorsement. So if I use myself as an example, first of all, I am so old, they weren't putting endorsements on certificates when they were issued, when I graduated. So I don't have endorsements on everything that I can teach, but my certificate says that I can teach general self-contained, I'm a reading teacher and a reading specialist. I also have a second certificate called my Type 75 General Administrator. So on my PEL, it's going to list self-contained, K-9, reading teacher, reading specialist, and general administration. So they're all going to be endorsements. You will have the same one PEL license, okay? Big change, how many of you remember, this, you have to go back a few years, you remember your superintendent or principal walking around in the spring saying, tomorrow or next week I'm going to the regional office, I need your certificate and $4 because I'm going to register your certificate. Anybody remember those days? Well, they're gone and they're not coming back. Not only will you not have an administrator walk around and collect your money, but after June 30th, you will not be able to pay for your registration fees or application fees in person at the regional office using cash, credit, or cash, checks, or money orders. Everything is going to be online. Also, your license will be online as well. The state stopped printing certificates about 2 years ago. So now, everything will be online, and that will be the only official document showing your new license. So that will be online. You will pay online with a credit card or a prepaid credit card. Now, the state, we try to encourage the state to include PayPal and debit cards, but up to this point, that hasn't happened. So I'm hopeful that maybe it still will, but as of right now, this new system that we're going to talk about in a minute only accepts credit cards and prepaid credit cards. Now, there are some things that you can do to protect yourself. The ECS system, which stands for Educator Certification System that you all use, at least I hope you all use it, that system is going away on June 30th. You will no longer be able to see it, to add anything to it, or to print from ECS after June 30th. The state board has said, and I believe that they're going to do this, they're going to archive ECS and they will be able to see it. But I don't want you all to be dependent on the state board for information. There are over 75,000 certificates throughout the state. That's retired teachers, active teachers, brand new teachers, so, and people that have moved out of state. So the state is going to be messing with 75,000 certificates. So we asked them as regional superintendents, where do you think there's going to be a problem? Because anytime you do that, technology-wise, something happens. Well, they said yes, but we don't think there are going to be any problems. I hope that's true. But there are some things you can do to help protect yourself. And these are bullet points toward the bottom of your page. There's some things you need to do. The first thing is you go into ECF and go into your personal account and make sure that your address, your phone number, and your email address are correct. The reason is, that's the only way I have to contact you. if the state calls me and says, we have an issue with Andrea Gannon's certificate, I know how to find her, but I don't know how to find all of you. So the only way I have is to look you up in the system and to use that contact information. So please make sure that's accurate. The second thing is, if your name is not correct, please, you can't change it in the system, but you have to come to the regional office with a photo ID. And it's free, it doesn't cost you anything. You're not required to do it because everything is tied to your social security number and your IEIN number, but it really is helpful if the last name matches the first name. So if your last name is the same in the system as it is on the, that you use. The second thing you need to do is go into the system and click on the word current credentials. That's on the left-hand side of ECS. Now I can tell you where all kinds of things are in ECS without looking because we've been there so often. The new system that we're going to talk about in a few minutes, we haven't even seen. So I don't even think the certification people at the state board have seen it. It's still in the archives and the technology people. So what you need to do is go into current credentials, and that will pull up your certificate. Print that page. That has some information that you're going to need to compare once the new license is out in July. So print the page, it shows your endorsements, it shows all the approvals you have, and it shows your renewal date. If you have more than one certificate, there's a bubble on the left-hand side of the certificate name. Click on the other bubble, and that will pull up your second certificate and print that page as well. So you're going to print your current credentials. Then you're going to go into the NCLB category and print anything that you are NCLB highly qualified to teach. And then finally, you're going to go into the professional development piece and print all of your professional development. I know that sometimes we save up all of our PD and we enter it all during the summer when things are a little bit slower. The new system that we're going to talk about in a minute will not accept professional development. You're not going to be putting your PD in online after July 1. So what the State Board is recommending is if you haven't put things in yet, you don't need to. But please keep all of the documentation that you have to prove that you've done that PD. I've said this before, it's so much easier to throw paper away that you don't need than try to recreate what you did. I don't remember professional development I did 6 months ago, much less 5 years ago. So it's just easier if you have it all with you and you keep that. You'll still be required to do professional development, but we're not going to be doing it in the new system. So you don't have to go back and enter everything you did this year in ECS. So those are the things you need to print. Then, and I would suggest you do that before June 29th when 74,999 other people are trying to print as well. Then after July 1, sometime in July, what you need to do is you need to pull out that paperwork, go into the new system, which is called ELIS, Educator License Information System. And it's probably going to be in the exact same spot on the State Board website. My guess would be that they'll just take out ECS, plug ELIS in. You'll probably have to do another login and password, but go into your system. And then what you need to do is you need to compare what was in ECS with what's in the new system. They have said that no one should be hurt in this process. They are not going to take anything away from you that you've already earned, okay? The state follows something called once qualified, always qualified, and we're going to talk about what that means to you in just a second. But what you need to do is you need to compare and make sure all of your endorsements are there, and that if you have multiple certificates, that all of your certificates are represented on your PEL. Okay, so that's the first thing. Look and see if you have approvals. Now, approvals are listed at the very bottom of the page. So if you have approvals, check to make sure they transferred as well. Then the next thing you need to do is look at the renewal date. On ECS, it's in the upper right-hand corner. For those of you with yellow sheet people, your renewal date should not change. It should be the exact same date. It will always be June the 30th, and then the year will change. It should be the same date on ECS as it is in Ellis, okay? Blue sheet people. How many people are blue sheet? Is there anybody here that has 4 years of teaching this year? Nope? Okay, then I don't need to talk about that. Blue sheet people, here's what we don't know about you all yet. And I have a meeting with the state tomorrow morning. I'm hoping we have some more answers. The initial certificate is going away. You will have a full five-year Pell license on July 1. But you are currently paid up for 4 years on your initial certificate. So there are a couple things that could happen. One, your renewal date could be the exact same date. Two, they could have it be a year longer and give it to you free. That's not going to happen. But they could. They could make it a year longer and you have to pay $10, or there's also talk that they're just going to make all the initial certificates due in 2018, and there may or may not be a fee to it. So we have to stay tuned. I can't give you exact answers yet, but I would really hope that by tomorrow I'll be able to do that. So if you have questions after July 1, and you can't tell whether you owe money or not, and this goes for both yellow sheet and blue sheet. There are two names at the bottom of the sheet. Norma and Donna are in the office all the time. They answer questions on the phone and up at the counter. So they're your best bet. I'm not in the office as much as they are. I'd be happy to talk with you, but it might be 2 or 3 days before I can get back with you. So they're the ones that you want to talk to if you have questions, especially after July 1. Now, what do you do if you don't have all of your endorsements on your new license? Don't panic. Just call our office, tell us what you had on the old ECS certificate, and then we'll talk to State Board. It happened when we made the exchange in 2000, so we can fix it, okay? Yellow sheet people, is there anyone here that is due to renew this year? Okay. There's a date change on the yellow sheet. My suggestion is that you submit your statement of assurance and you pay for your renewal fees before June the 1st. The reason is that and you can do that using cash, check, or money order at our office, just like you always have, up until the end of June. But if you do it by June 1st, then we know it's gonna go all the way through the cycle. So that when the switchover happens, you have a certificate that's valid until 2018 and you don't have to worry. You can wait until after July the 1st, but I have the feeling that the system's gonna have bugs. So I would feel more comfortable if I were you doing that. Okay, so we've talked about Ellis and when to renew and entering your professional development. Once qualified, always qualified. This is a tremendous benefit to you. What that means is that if you were once qualified to do something, no matter how the state changes the rule, you will always be qualified to do it. For example, I had, when I first started, reading endorsements weren't put on the certificate, so I did not have a reading endorsement, but if I decided tomorrow that I wanted to quit being a regional superintendent and go back and teach reading, I could do that because I was always once qualified. Now, this has not happened yet, what I'm about to tell you, okay? So don't start writing a letter. But there is someone at the state board who doesn't like the once qualified, always qualified, and they are considering trying to remove it. You don't want that to happen. And you have the ability, doing something called public comment, to let them know why you don't like that and why you think it needs to stay. If this happens, I will let your administration know how to let you know how to do public comment and what are some possible ways you can, what are some things you should say. You shouldn't just say, I don't like it, that's a stinky idea. They need to have reason. But the only political thing I'm saying today, but I would really, really encourage you, if that comes to pass, let them know, because it really is a tremendous benefit to you. For example, right now, middle school endorsements require 18 hours. The new proposed rules say 24 hours at a test. So you don't want to have to go back and take more hours, six more hours plus a test, just to be able to keep a middle school endorsement. So if that happens, I'll let you know. The next thing is about LAP certificates. LAP certificates mean that you have not either completed PD, you didn't submit your statement of insurance, or you haven't paid fees. Under the old system, it took 5 years for a certificate to lapse. Under this new law, it takes only 6 months. And without a valid certificate, you cannot teach, okay? So you don't want to let your certificate lapse. To earn back, put your certificate back in good standing, you can do one of two things. You could take 9 semester hours, and then your certificate could be restored, or you can pay the state board $500. I think the best idea is just not to let your certificate lapse. So keep track of that renewal date. The other thing I need to let you know is the change that is coming in recertifying your certificate and how you earn professional development. Remember I said that you wouldn't be putting your professional development into Ellis. That is because we are going to revamp that this year. I don't know, nothing has been written. It has to be put into a bill. It has to be passed by both the houses and the General Assembly, signed by the governor, rules and regs, that whole nine yards. It's gonna take a while. But when it happens, some things are gonna change. Again, the state board promised that nobody's gonna be hurt in that process. This one I'm a little less sure about, because I think there are a couple groups from what we've heard the state board start to talk about that I think could get hurt. So we'll work really hard to make sure that doesn't happen. They do ask us for feedback. They don't always do what we suggest, but they do ask. So what I can promise you is this. If, when the change occurs, if it's easy, straightforward, I don't think there'll be a lot of questions, I'll just do a webinar, and it would save me a boatload of time because we have over 105 schools in our county, and I'm going to every school and talking, so you can imagine how much time that takes. But if I can do it with the webinar, I will. But if I think that you guys need to have the opportunity to ask questions, I'll do this again next fall when everything is finalized. We've only had one conversation with the state about what they want to do, and things have already changed, so I'm afraid if I talk too much about it, then you'll just remember the things that we think might happen and not what really is. So I just promise you that I will let you know when I know, for sure. And the suggestion from the state is just to continue doing whatever professional development you're already doing, keep all the documentation, and you should be fine. What they have told us, they've told us two things that I think are pretty close to being set in stone. One is that it won't require any more than 120 CPDUs. The second thing is for those people that have a Type 73 certificate, but they maintain a license and you're not required to do professional development with your certificate, which will be another license, but you have to do professional development to keep your national license, you will not be required to do more than what it takes to keep that national IDPR or whatever your national license is. That doesn't apply to school nurses, however, because for some reason they don't think that you have enough professional development. I don't know, but they just don't let you do that. So I'm sorry, that's not me. Remember, I don't make any of these rules, I just have to tell you about them. So. Do you have questions for me? If you have questions that the whole group might hear, now would be a great time to ask. Otherwise, if you have individual questions, I'll stay and answer whatever you need. Does anybody have anything for the bigger group? Yeah, I did a good job. Well, thank you so very much for coming. I appreciate you taking time out today. Have a great day.